You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome to THE100. This is our second broadcast in this Young Scholars program that features high schoolers from all over the state and a look at how film, television, and theater provide us with some very interesting forms of entertainment as well as information. So today we're going to look at a very important part of this whole performance art. And that is the audience. What a perfect place to start, but to look at the importance of the audience. So we're going to spend a little time looking at some history, starting with Africa, talk about the audience, and then in the second half, I have a very special guest coming to join us, an actress, director, who has also written a number of things for our program here at Dominguez Hills, Naomi Buckley. So I look forward to talking with her about community-based theater. Kind of a unique form of theater that we do here at Dominguez. So in keeping with our role as theater directors, there's a phone number that hopefully you can get interactive with us. That's what we like to do in theater. So 1-800-339-1193, anywhere from North America, and you have a free phone call with me. So I'd love to hear from you, get some insights into your look at how important the audience is to theater, film, and television. Or you may want to join our students at dhtv.csudh.edu/ask in order to type a response or a question. And from the booth here, they'll send me to these monitors your comments. So I will get to at least read it here on the broadcast, which gives us something of an interaction. It's not the best form of discussion, but it can serve. So I look forward to hearing from you either on the phone or online. To our topics that we're looking at today. As I had mentioned last week, we usually start this program with some announcements, and of course, since we're beginning this semester, want to spend a little time just clarifying what's up in terms of if you're a Young Scholars program student and you want to make sure you're on track with us here. Today, in fact, many of you are doing your quiz and working on your discussion board. And as I said last week, the most important thing you can do is every weekend just go to the assignment page on our Blackboard website. And if you don't mind, Maria, who is directing today, can you maybe take me to my website here and we can show them exactly what I'm referring to on the assignment page? Here's your buttons to the left, but notice that the entire course is pretty much laid out for you week by week in terms of your assignments. And here we are, week two, February 11th. So when you click on here, you go right into what is expected this week. So reading the lecture that we have posted, going to the read chapters 2 and 3 in Wilson's book, The Theater Experience. I even have the chapters here in case you're using a past edition. Here's the textbook quiz. So that is up already. In fact, if we scroll down, you can see this is how you take the quiz. You just click on this link and it will take you through a series of questions. In fact, it's meant to be a learning experience, so you get to take it twice if you'd like, if you're not happy with your initial score. Here's Watch the Broadcast, and that's what you're doing, hopefully, out there at 3 o'clock on February 11th. And then here's our discussion board assignment, where you post a new thread based on something that you've read in the chapter that you thought was interesting, and then you reply to another student's posting. So as you would expect in the discussion board, if I go to the discussions here, you'll see that in week two, here we are in week two, it's on the audience, and already we have a couple of students like Michaela and Zachary and Christopher who are posting their responses. And then they will also have students replying to what they've mentioned. So that's a lot of what is happening right now. We're kind of getting up to task on reading our textbook, and this is our 12th edition here of The Theater Experience by Edwin Wilson. Wonderful, wonderful book, beautifully illustrated, and I think wonderfully written as well. So chapters 2 and 3 on the audience were due today, and that's what the quiz is covering, and that's what you're writing about on your discussion board. Now, I won't do this every week, but I'm just kind of laying out what's expected here. Another thing that we're doing this week, hopefully I'd like you to get to it right away because we're at the beginning of the semester, are the bios. So if you were to go onto the blog button on your website and click on blog, it'll bring you to a section where you introduce yourself. And a number of students have already done this. I'll embarrass some students out there today. Let me do that. I always enjoy doing that. Here's Lisette. Lisette wrote a little bit about what she's been doing, and she's actually performing as a dancer in a show coming up at the end of the semester at St. Matthias Academy. So interesting that we have a dancer on board. So that's great, Lisette. Thank you for sharing that information with us. Let's see, who else can I embarrass here? Here's Brandon. Let's see what Brandon's up to. So the bio is basically a chance to just kind of tell us where you're coming from. See, he's written a me, myself, and I. And as Brandon talks about, he's one of seven siblings, and I believe he's got one right there with him. So that's a great picture. Thanks for sending that to us, Brandon. And Brandon's at Riverside Classical Academy. Okay, one more. Let me embarrass somebody else. Let's see, who can I embarrass here? Let's look at Hannah. Okay, Hannah has an interesting picture too. I think it's very telling when someone presents a picture that shows, you know, a really good angle, that the lighting is great. It's not too big. Well, it's kind of big, but Hannah explains here in her posting that she really enjoys theater, and she talks about her living situation. I just want to read one thing that Hannah actually said, which I think is a very nice piece of writing. And Hannah, I really am delighted that you shared this with us. She writes, "I live in Big Bear Lake, California, and it has been the best place to grow up. Big Bear is a very small town of only about 20,000, 25,000 people. I have known many of my closest friends today since preschool. We do not have too many options of activities for our free time, but my friends and I go out on hikes, especially taking photos of nature. However, my small community has its ups and downs. We are so close-knit here that you cannot walk into a grocery store and not see someone you don't know. But because you know so many people know you, and nothing can stay a secret. If something grand happens, you just learn to expect that in 30 minutes after the occurrence, the entire valley will already know what's going on." So I think, Hannah, that clarifies a lot of what your situation is. And you talk about how Big Bear High School has very similar kind of connectedness in your situation. That's what I'm looking for. And quite honestly, that's what a playwright does. They take us into depth in terms of the human experience. That's really what we're after. So I'd say, Hannah, you're ready to join my playwriting class next and start producing some work that'll put your experience on stage. After all, playwriting is very autobiographical. Anyway, that's a lot of what's happening in the class. So I just want the young scholars out there to be aware that we're kind of expecting your bio, get a picture in there as well as some information about yourself, and get onto that discussion board this week, and certainly make sure you finish your quiz because there's a lot of points that accumulate for all these quizzes. One other piece of information before we move on with the actual show. We're doing a unique performance here. I know some of you, Lisette, who live in Downey, might be interested in seeing a show here on campus. I know most of you are actually much further away and will probably want to see shows in your nearby area. But we open a show in a little over 2 weeks that is quite a drama. It is called Top Dog Underdog, and it won the Pulitzer Prize in 2002 for Susan Laurie Parks. You can see that there's a poster here that we're putting up. I don't know if you can read all the text, but it's going to open not this coming Thursday, but the following Thursday. So we have a little more than 2.5 weeks before the show opens, and it runs for 2 weeks. Oh, there's, great, thank you. Opens the 27th, that's a Thursday night. It's in our small theater, which is the Edison Studio Theater. Very interesting to be in a theater situation where there's only 70 seats around you, so it creates a kind of intimacy. And it's about these two black brothers who are really have a battle with each other. That's pretty much what the show is. There's no other actors in the show. It's just these two men. And as you see, adult themes and language. So I do want to forewarn you that there's some very strong language that's in the play. And that's important for you to realize before you walk into any of our shows or any show as well. So yes, there's some pretty riveting. There's a lot of humor in the play, but it's, I would call it a very serious drama. Unlike The School for Scandal, which opens for us in April. I don't have a poster yet for that to show you, but I will definitely try to get you to come on campus and see School for Scandal, which is a hilarious restoration comedy, a great classic, and that's directed by another faculty member, Kelly Herman. This one, Top Dog, is directed by our new faculty member, Sherelle Luckett. So we're very excited to have her contributing to our program as well. So anyway, that's news of the world, what's coming up in theater arts here, theater and dance, Top Dog, Underdog, a very unique play. So let's talk a little bit about the audience. Before I do, I just want to encourage you to interact with us. And one of the ways that we do that is provide you with a focus question. So let's provide this. How do you feel that your background will influence your experience of seeing a show? Very much to the heart of what Wilson writes about in both chapters 2 and 3 today. But even if you haven't read the chapters, I'd be curious to hear, how do you think your background is going to determine perhaps how you're going to enjoy a show? So it does take some interesting thought there before you may want to log on to the internet and perhaps type a comment, and I will be able to bring it up here. Or you may want to call us on that toll-free number and just talk about it. I'm very happy to entertain your call. So 1-800-339-1193, or you may want to log on to the internet and talk with us that way. Okay, as I mentioned last week, what we do at the very beginning is to just give you a little bit of a sense of history of the theater. And no place better to start than with Africa. Africa provides a ritual foundation that in many cultures is still very apparent. So probably the most unique place to start. If you were to look at a map of Africa, as the Europeans did at first, when they came in, they thought that Africa was devoid of any kind of writing. They don't have any theater. This is a barbaric country. It is the heart of darkness, as it was called. Oddly enough, there was theater done everywhere, even in the northern areas, which had certain restrictions against use of masks, for instance, due to the Islamic influence. But all through West Africa, the middle, the Congo areas, South Africa, very extensive use of mask dancing and the use of ritual. After all, the African worldview is much different than the European. For the African, man lives in a very nature-bound world where you're connected to your community as well as to nature. And the values that come out in storytelling and music and dance and costumes are all reflections of their particular way of seeing the world. Ritual is really the main mention here that we should focus on, because, and notice, remember from last week, I want to just point out that when you see a graphic like this, make sure you write it down. So ritual is probably going to be on the exam. That's the only way you'll find out what's going to be on the midterm and the finals, is to see on the broadcast what graphics come up. So yes, a ritual is very similar to theater in that we're talking about a group action. It has to have some kind of sacred setting. It has to have a use of characters, and those characters are often in masks or costumes. There's usually sacred music so that the dancers can move to that music. The intention in a ritual is to call forth spirits that will help us. And that is perhaps what makes it different from theater, because theater is not necessarily a religious action. In other words, imploring some kind of help, what the Cambridge anthropologist called the sympathetic magic of ritual. Although actors will tell you today that there is something very significant about a piece of theater that makes it equally as powerful as ritual in mobilizing very important spiritual connections with an audience. But anyway, that is the main distinction. Ritual is religious. Theater is more entertainment, as we sometimes say. And one perfect way to look at Africa are the long history of the use of mummies. In Egypt, for instance, the idea of crafting the actual body of the pharaoh or whoever is being sent up to meet with the god Ra, it would be done in such an elegant way that it would carry a divine image. Now, this is Sacehuti, and she is actually a friend of the queen. She's not actually a pharaoh. So there were priests, there were pharaohs, wives, a variety of people who were given this extensive treatment. But the idea with the sarcophagus decorated in one, it's almost like a huge mask that was developed so that your king, your special person, could be seen in their divine essence. It was a portrait, not so much of their realistic look, as much as the spirit inside, the divine part of them. So yeah, there's a long history there in terms of the use of mummy masks. But Africa is most known for its many ritual dances that feature like the Bamara tribe in West Africa will use masks like this to, interesting little superstructure there above the head, which is designed to help implore the spirits for help. And this is a very strong agricultural community that use this mask. So the dancers are not just wearing a mask, they have a whole costume as well. In addition to ritual, realize too that Africa has theater as well. So for instance, the Afikpo tribe have a performance that goes on for a number of days, which they call the Akumka play. And here is a boy with a mask performing in front of a gathered community. These plays feature like 100 masked performers doing a variety of songs and dances and mimes and skits. And a lot of them refer to contemporary events, not just like mythological stories, but they are included as well. So Africa, all throughout Africa, has a long history. We're talking about hundreds of different languages here, not just one large country, realize. So many different cultures are represented here. Of course, the effects of colonialism, once by the 1900s, Europe has moved in, mainly France and England, but most European powers had taken over one of the countries of Africa. Now that the slave trade was stopped, many of these European countries began taking the raw materials from Africa and created the colonial system, which had very severe impact in Africa. Not only were school curriculums brought in and the European languages brought in, government bureaucracy, but a way of doing theater, such that the Christian missionaries really discouraged any of the ritual activities. And that disrupted in a very strong way much of the theatrical traditions. And then when the independence movement happened and many of these countries like Nigeria and Kenya or whatever had overthrown the European powers, they put in a new structure called neocolonialism, where you would have black rulers, but a lot of the same structures were there in place. So I guess my point is African theater was disrupted in a very severe way. And it's only recently, since like the 60s and 70s, that we have writers like Wole Soyinka in Nigeria. Soyinka was educated in the West, but he wrote a lot of plays that focused on ritual traditions there in Nigeria. The Strong Breed, for instance, was a play that he wrote that made use of a kind of sacrificial ritual that was used in his attempt to say that the person who is willing to sacrifice is truly the leader in modern Africa as well. Death and the King's Horseman. He wrote a number of plays that were played worldwide and showed a lot of the problems that were happening in Africa. In fact, Death of a King's Horseman shows a connection with Igungun ritual ceremonies. So he stayed true to his African roots in many ways, and yet wrote in English and was able to be published in English countries, and won the Nobel Prize in 1986, the first African to do so. So quite a distinction there. Just wanted to introduce a little bit of Africa. There's a much longer story, believe me. Africa has contributed something unique called developmental theater. Some of the problems for communities in Africa, like AIDS-related problems, the mortality rate in Africa, still very strong. So we started to get theater companies in Zimbabwe, all over actually in West Africa, that started using theater to help communities learn how to deal with health crises, many problems, especially when we start getting into the ethnic cleansing that goes on in Central Africa. So in a strange way, they created theater that was designed to educate communities. It was called developmental theater, and that form actually came to America. We have theater companies here called Cornerstone Theater, for instance, which wanted to do plays that were going to be helpful to their communities, that were going to be informative, to help create social change by using theater. So Africa contributed in a unique way, a different brand of theater that can still be entertaining, but at the same time has some kind of social import. More of Africa later, I'm sure, but that's just to kind of kick off a little bit of our history of theater, and next week we'll visit a different country as well. Okay, so we're asking, how do you think your background can experience your seeing of a show? That's our focus question for today. I see we already have some students who've joined the group. That's great. Thank you so much for contributing. And again, feel free to call 1-800-339-1193 or do what Christopher Kane just did, which is to go onto our website and type a response, and I'll be able to read it at least. So yes, Christopher, thank you. Christopher's saying, cultural background makes a huge difference in how a show is viewed and interpreted. Cultural elements can define plot, acting style, and a script profoundly. Different plays are often culture tailored. I guess that's the end of the prompt. So to some extent, where you're coming from, I think this is what Christopher's saying, where you're coming from is going to determine how you accept the play, how you interpret it. And that is very strong in what Wilson's telling us about this. And many of the plays are culture tailored. I like how you said that, Christopher, because it may be designed to help a very specific community. Middle of the 60s, we're not there yet in our history sequence, but many African-American plays were very angry, and angry for good reason in terms of what was happening in America at the time. And it was like a civil rights expression. So that made African-Americans start writing plays not for white audiences, but for only blacks. And that was unusual that you'd have a particular play designed just for a particular audience, done only by particular performers. But it became quite necessary in that environment. Well, Christopher, thank you for starting us off, and I hope some of your students will join you on looking at how the experience that you're coming from is going to affect how you're going to take to the show. So let's talk a little bit about chapters 2 and 3 on the audience. And I'm very glad that Wilson had this idea of starting with the audience. That's the ideal place to start if you certainly want your performance to have some relevance to the audience. You need to be aware of who's out there. I found an interesting piece of writing by Stefan Melnick, who is a communications scholar. And he wrote a book once that talked about what audiences' needs are. In other words, when you go to a theater or a film theater, you have certain needs. You're looking for something. And Melnick described them as pleasure, information, escape, and companionship. And really, all four of those are quite wonderful. Pleasure, obviously. If you're going and watching spectacle, there's something pleasurable about that. I don't know if anyone saw Miss Saigon, but to see a helicopter come down from the wings, some of the great spectacle that you see is very pleasurable to watch. Obviously, film effects do that quite a lot. TV commercials are famous for that, providing that sense of pleasure. If you look at conflict, sometimes watching conflict can be a source of pleasure. Shows like Survivor kind of capitalize on the battle between two different warring groups, right? Obviously, another form of pleasure is sex. How many times have you seen women carrying beers to their men on a television commercial, right? So yes, that is a source of pleasure as well. But also, there's a sense of order that comes with a play or with a film. It establishes a pleasing feeling that things are going to be okay. I think we mentioned a little bit last week that a play basically is something going wrong and then somebody fixing it and letting us leave the theater knowing that it's all going to be okay. So there is some kind of order that comes from pleasure as well. So perhaps Melnick is on to something that is very important for us as we go to the theater. Obviously, information. Long before film, long before computers, people went to theater to find out what was happening. It was the only community action. It was the only source of information before there were even newspapers. In fact, interesting that in the 1930s, 1940s, a form of theater was developed called living theater, where you'd actually see a newspaper on stage and actors would come out and play scenes from local events that had just happened. So this living newspaper was a form of getting, a way of getting information, getting caught up on current events. So yes, theater does provide that. Obviously, your television news is going to provide that for you as well. So yes, we need information. We also need to escape, and that is a major reason to go to the theater, as more so probably to go to film. Supposedly 80 million people a week went to films in 1932 because of the Depression. People needed to get away from the grim reality of what was going on. In fact, in 1945, the height of World War II, 85 million went to the film theaters every week. So it tells you that film does provide a chance to put the lights out and just go away for 2 hours to some wonderful place where you can watch Lawrence of Arabia ride across the desert, right? So yes, escape as well as information and pleasure. And finally, he talks about companionship. Oddly enough, you get a sense of connectedness where you, like in a theater, you identify with the characters, you become close to them, you kind of understand what they're going through, you feel what they're going through. And you tend to like characters, not objectively, you like them in almost a very empathetic way. And add to that the personal charm of a lot of the particular actors. Walter Cronkite became such a major figure in America as the anchorman for the news because people just kind of felt he was like a father figure for them. Sometimes people come home and they'll put on the television and they'll go in the kitchen and they'll start dinner. They leave the television on. Nobody's watching it. Why would they do that? It's like having someone there in the room. So we do have a need for companionship, and that does bring us to see theater and film and television. So interesting concept that theater, film, television provides us with pleasure, information, escape, and a sense of companionship, all very human needs. So realize that it's not just an entertainment form. It provides us with something quite valuable. All right, I see we have Danielle here today. Great, Danielle. Thank you for contributing your comment on how our background is going to affect how we watch a show. Danielle says, I think that people would want to see a play that they can relate to. So if they are in a relationship, they may want to see a romantic play. And that is, it's great that you point that out, Danielle, that a lot of the reason why flicks that appeal to those who are perhaps out there on a date, or maybe you're not going on a date. Maybe you're going to kind of match what's happening in your relationship with what's happening to poor Drew Barrymore in her relationship. It does give us kind of a way of having a friend almost to talk about what you're going through in your relationship. So I think there's a lot of truth to that, Danielle, that romantic films are so popular because many of us need a little bit of that connection there to understand what's happening with ours. And here's Mike. Interesting, Mike, you're telling me some terrible news here. Shirley Temple died today. She was a unifying force for the country during the Depression. Her immense popularity prompted Franklin Delano Roosevelt to say that as long as our country has Shirley Temple, we will be all right. Well, unfortunately, FDR, I don't know what's going to happen now that we've missed Shirley Temple. But through many, many dark years of World War II and in the 50s and later, that vibrant personality was enlivening our spirits. So I'm very sad to see that happened today. But yes, we sometimes go to the theater, to a film, to get a sense of enthusiasm about living life, especially when maybe we have lost a little bit from losses that we've experienced. So film, television, even watching television can, I think, provide a kind of healing. It allows us to get over some very difficult patches in our life. Of course, I'm speaking as a much older teenager than many of you in the Young Scholar program. So, but I think you'll find that you'll find comfort in many of the films and television programs and theater pieces that you watch in your life that relate to you. So very good. I like Danielle's point about something that you can relate to, and that is very much a reason to go to the theater. Okay, I also want to point out that one of the things Wilson was focusing on was how audience brings many of these of needs, and that one of the things that you focus on is your own knowledge and your own personal memories. So in terms of the expectations and the background of the audience, that's huge. Your knowledge, your personal memories play quite a game in helping you. Here's this wonderful quote by Jean-Claude Van Italy, who was a playwright from the 1960s and 70s. And Van Italy, I don't know if you have our edition here, but on page 28, it's at the very beginning there of chapter 2, and he says, "Theater is not electronic. Unlike movies and unlike television, it does require the live presence of both audience and actors in a single space. This is the theater's uniquely important advantage and function. Its original religious function of bringing people together in a community ceremony where the actors are in some sense priests and celebrants, and the audience is drawn to participate with the actors in a kind of Eucharist." Very interesting the way he wrote that, as that there is some kind of religious feeling that goes on in a theater even today. So I think it's very much what we were just referring to, that sometimes your personal memories, your own knowledge can be quite connected in almost a spiritual way there with that performer who we think is an actor, but they actually function somewhat as a shaman or a priest or a religious figure. Also, wonderful insights that he has on the functions of symbols in theater and film and how we relate to that and the use of realism and non-realism. Very important factors here. The awareness of the world of the play around us is very strategic. He goes into that in chapter 3, as well as information about the playwright and the play. That helps us enormously to understand and further gain insight from what the playwright's writing. But yes, our expectations, what we think will happen, sometimes depends a lot on where we're coming from in our own experience. I want to just look at some of the unique differences that he points out between realism and non-realism in chapter 2, because obviously the live actor draws our attention so strongly in a piece of theater. And Vanatali was talking about that in his comment about the immediacy of having a live actor there. There's something magical about being in that relationship with a performer. Aesthetic distance is something that Wilson points out, that we do need some kind of separation between actor and audience member to help us appreciate a work of art. So it's that needed separation that allows us to perceive and appreciate it, aesthetic distance, very good term. And it also helps us to see that it's different from ritual, because ritual originally is where everyone danced in a ceremony. Whereas in theater, there's a separation between those who are watching and those who are performing. And that's necessary. Even in some cases where theater can be designed to be very interactive and you have actors coming into the audience to perform. So they may be sitting right next to you, as in many shows that I witnessed from the 60s. Realism. Very interesting concept, which you would think has always been with us. But realism is a latecomer in the world of the history of theater. It wasn't until like the 1860s, 1870s, we actually get a term called realism, and plays are designed to show us a kind of resemble observable reality. That's what realism is. It's a kind of photographic truth, such that you see costumes that look exactly like clothes that we wear every day. But it hadn't always been realistic. We've had many performances in Shakespeare, for instance, that are highly imaginative. In fact, Shakespeare, I'm going to show you a little clip here that features Derek Jacobi performing a speech where he basically is asking the audience to use your imagination to help us put together this scene, because we don't have enough actors to play it out for you. So, in non-realistic theater, where you're looking at an audience member, talking to them face to face, that's not realistic. You're jumping kind of across the stage there. It breaks what we call the fourth wall and makes for a kind of immediacy that realistic theater wouldn't have. So I think you'll get an idea from this little clip here that we're going to show. This is the opening of Henry V, and you'll see that the narrator, who is the chorus member of the play, is kind of asking you to piece out our imperfections with your thoughts. In other words, use your brain to see this famous battle of Agincourt. So this is from Henry V.
Oh, for a muse of fire that would ascend the brightest heaven of invention. A kingdom for a stage. Princes to act. And monarchs to behold the swelling sea. Then should the warlike Harry, like himself, assume the port of Mars, and at his heels, leashed in like hounds, to famine, sword, and fire crouch for employment. But pardon, gentles all, the flat, unraised spirits that have dared on this unworthy scaffold bring forth so great an object. Can this cockpit hold the vasty fields of France? Or may we cram within this wooden O the very casks that did affright the air at Agincourt? Oh, pardon. And let us ciphers to this great account on your imaginary forces work. What is your thoughts that now must deck our kings? Carry them here and there, jumping all times, turning the accomplishment of many years into an hourglass. For the which supply, admit me, chorus to this history. Who, prologue-like, your humble patience pray. Gentle.
I hope you could kind of gather what he was saying. Oh, for a muse of fire. In other words, I wish we had some fire that could tell you the story. A kingdom for a stage, princes to act, and monarchs to behold the swelling scene. In other words, this is such a grand event that I'm describing. We really need the whole kingdom to show it to you. We need princes to be on stage. But all we've got are these 15 guys in our theater company, and in order for you to really see it, you have to imagine it. So the whole history of classical theater is based on non-realism, of getting the audience to see it in their own heads, and thus most of classical theater is very poetic, as is Shakespeare. There are many non-realistic things that, for instance, came out of Shakespeare, like the idea of doing a soliloquy. A soliloquy, as Hamlet speaks to be or not to be, is when we have a single character who's speaking either to the audience or to himself, as Hamlet does, expressing kind of their inner thoughts. Technically, actually, Hamlet spoke directly to the audience when, in his day, it was done. But we often see that speech done as like thinking out loud, which is more of what a soliloquy is. But it's non-realistic. When we have thoughts to ourselves, we don't say them out loud. Well, maybe some of you do, I guess. I don't know, maybe you should think about becoming actors. But another form of non-realism is pantomime, when you have a performer who is pretending to be using actual objects that are not present. There's another one of those graphics there, so you may want to write this down. But pantomime is, again, another example of non-realistic theater, but look at the impact that it can have, especially in the hands of a great performer like Jean-Louis Barrault. This is a little clip from an old movie called Children of Paradise. See if you can figure out what the mime, Barrault, is saying in his nonverbal gestures in this scene from Children of Paradise. It doesn't matter if he didn't follow every little part there, but what he was describing was how the woman in the audience was being accused by this rich man of stealing his watch, but it was actually some robber who took his watch and ran off, but the rich man just looked and saw her and said, "You took my watch," and they brought the policeman in. So the mime, who watched the whole thing, said, "Wait a minute, I'll show you what really happened," and he does this whole pantomime. Now, watching that, it's actually easy to follow because you're imagining the objects that he's grabbing, like the watch, but yet you know it's fake Isn't it interesting how you can go along with that and buy into believing that that's really storytelling? Well, that's what Samuel Taylor Coleridge was speaking about when he mentioned the willing suspension of disbelief. Interesting phrase that refers to how we in the audience will buy into, will believe something that we know is fake. It's a piece of theater and they've done it 50 times before. But yet, there we are out there crying and laughing. We go along with it. We totally believe what's happening. So we're kind of like actors carrying on a deception even as we watch in the audience. So don't think that the audience is just a sedentary, passive group of people. There's a lot of participation that goes into being an audience member that usually involves your imagination or the willing suspension of disbelief, which is another aspect of our imagination. Here's Caitlin. Caitlin has an interesting observation. I believe that your background has a lot to do with what type of theater you like. If you're a joyful person, you're not going to enjoy a sad play as much as one that would be happy. And I agree with you very much, Caitlin, that the theater is almost, to some extent, a mirror. When we go there, we're looking to see ourselves. I mean, we don't say that consciously to ourselves, but what we are hoping we're going to see is a reflection of something that is very much about us. So I agree with you. If you're a kind of bubbly person, maybe you're going to go enjoy a comedy more than you would a sad play. Here's Burgundy saying, your background influences not only our interpretation of the show, but also our enjoyment. Seeing a show on a subject that you have no background or understanding in makes it hard to take anything from. And I think that's a unique part of theater as well, Burgundy, that sometimes it's great to see work that you're not too familiar with. And that's been my joy in theater, because theater is so diverse. And I don't mean just variety of ethnicities. There are so many kinds of theater. Obviously, he covers a great deal of Broadway theater, regional theater, college theater, community theater, children's theater. There's so many different types and forms, and the way that playwrights have written them in so many different ways, it makes theater a rather exciting place. So sometimes if you've never gone to see a restoration comedy, you may want to join us to come and see School for Scandal. But you're right, it will be a bit of a stretch for you to be kind of comfortable with that. So, yes, what the audience brings is rather unique. In fact, I don't know, do you feel that when you go to a movie and when you go to see a live show that in a way you behave differently? Do you find yourself almost reacting in a different way when it's a live piece of theater around you than when it's a film? Some will say that a film is a very kind of personal, it's like you're alone when you're watching a film, whereas when you're watching a piece of theater, you're with many people. You get the feeling that you're part of a much larger group. So to some extent, your reactions are very unique, except that I find it always interesting in a film when sometimes at the end of the film, the audience will clap, applaud that they liked it so much. I mean, that derives from live shows when the cast would come out and you'd actually give the actors, live people, your applause, your appreciation. But it's always interesting to see in a film theater, the actors aren't there, but the audience still wants to participate their appreciation for the show. I think it's great. Well, listen, I think we're going to take a little break here. And when we come back, I want to introduce you to our guest who's going to talk with us about community-based theater. Wilson talks a little bit about community theater in his chapter 3, but this is a little different than community theater, though it does certainly involve bringing people from the community into not just what the show is about, but into the process of creating the show. So I'll let our guest Naomi Buckley help define that for you when we come back from our break. So look forward to talking to you a little bit more about the audience and community-based theater in Theater 100.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Grant Wagner, and I'm a teacher here at Menachie High School. And I've had the good fortune to be involved with the Young Scholar Program through CSU Dominguez Hills for over 10 years. We have encouraged our kids to take on this opportunity, this challenge, for various reasons. One, it allows our students, for a very nominal fee, $3.50 for a college class, to experience what college is going to be like.
What I like best about the program is how it fits to your schedule. Like, you can watch the lectures whenever is convenient for you, and it's really easy to talk to the professors.
And these students, whether they pass or fail, are learning some valuable lessons about what it's like to be a college student.
The thing I like best about the courses I take through the Young Scholar Program is the difficulty of the courses. And a lot of people think that they're easy to take, but they're actually pretty difficult, and they challenge you, and they really make you think, and that's how college is going to be, so it really prepares you for college.
This program is really an incentive for students that have a 3.0 grade point average and are ready to face the rigors of the college environment.
I encourage students to enroll in the Young Scholar Program at California State University Dominguez Hills because of the advantages they have when they leave high school. They have college credit at an incredible value.
What Dominguez Hills is to me is actually just a great learning environment for me because of the Young Scholars Program. It's really helped me just know a lot more about marine biology and astronomy, and currently just like logic and just the individual in society. It's just all great classes, and it's really nice to like use something that you don't really learn in high school, get outside information from Dominguez Hills, and just apply that to the outside world.
This series of classes allows our high school students, it empowers them to solve their own problems. And the Young Scholar Program allows the kids to do that.
I'm a senior at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
This is my university.
Hey Mark, nice paper.
Now this.
Sweet.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. This is Bill DeLuca at THE100, and I'm just delighted to be able to bring to you one of my favorite stars of the stage, Naomi Buckley, who is a faculty member with us. She's a part-timer, but she's also an alum of our program. She went through the Dominguez Hills theater program and was quite a talented actor, director, playwright as well. She has many shows that she's always working on. She's directing a show, Spring Awakening, right now. In fact, I think she'll tell us a little bit about how the auditions went last night. But Naomi, thank you for joining us. It's always great to have you here.
Always. Nice to be here.
One of our own. So Naomi, I asked Naomi to come talk to us about community-based theater because at Dominguez Hills, we've had a kind of unique experience. And perhaps because we're a smaller program, we're not a program that has like 250 theater majors as many others. We have a small number of students, and by being small, we have the advantage of working with other groups. So for instance, Naomi was very instrumental years back in doing the Vagina Monologues, which we did 6 years in a row. And the reason why we did that was to raise money for local shelters. That same idea that I was telling you before about African theater, of doing theater for a social purpose. That is exactly what Naomi has brought to this. And we helped develop a program on campus called Teatro Dominguez, which allows our students to tour shows to local schools. And these shows are shows like works that Naomi has written in the past. Actually, she wrote one with me last summer called Coyotita, which features animals from the air and land and the sea, kind of finding out how important it is to be concerned about the environment. So it was like an environmental children's show, and that played. Naomi took it and toured it to local schools in the Carson area, and she's even worked with the Aquarium of the Pacific. So I'll let you tell us about that. But I do want to hear, how did your auditions go last night?
They went really well. They went incredibly well. We had a ton of people come out, and we had 40 people.
This is for Springs.
I'm directing Spring Awakening. There's my camera. I'm directing Spring Awakening at Orange Coast College in Costa Mesa, and which opens the beginning of May, May 2nd. And we had our first night of auditions last night. And we had a ton of people come out from all over, from UCI and CSULB. We didn't have any of our Dominguez students yet. I'm hoping they'll come Wednesday. And from the Orange Coast Community College District. So it was very successful. It was a very long night. We had a lot more people than we expected, and so we were there quite late. But it was run very smoothly. I have a stage manager and two assistant stage managers. So
That helps enormously.
Yeah. So and it went very, very well. I was very excited. The music director was very excited about what we saw.
Yes, this is a major rock musical that I'm sure if you're a high school student, as many of you are in the Young Scholars Program, you're probably aware of this. Even though it starts from an 1890s play by Franz Wedekind, but it was very updated. And some of the issues in it are pretty relevant to contemporary audiences. So it'll be interesting to see how you do this, because we did it 2 years ago here. So I'm looking forward to seeing what results you get. But let's talk about community-based theater. And do you want to take a stab at defining that for us? What do we mean when we're talking about community-based theater?
Well, I think one of the important things is that we want to distinguish between what's the difference between community theater, which I think we hear a lot about, and community-based theater, because I think sometimes those two get confused. And community theater is theater that's taking place all over the country, not just all over the country, all over the world, really. And it involves doing productions of any type. They publish plays or unpublished plays, or sometimes variety shows, where we use community members, amateur actors, or sometimes even professional actors, to perform for the community. Whereas community-based theater is where we're actually writing to and for the communities that we're working in. And we may also use people from the community in our productions, but it's different in that we're actually drawing stories or themes from the community that we plan to perform for. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the really the big differences, is that we are creating theater for the audience that we intend to come and watch it, which is different from just community theater. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and because of that, we can have a different kind of impact. So we can talk about political or socioeconomic issues or environmental issues that we think are relevant to the community that we want to focus on. You know, Bill knows this, but you might not.
What better way to make the show relevant, mm-hmm. but to begin by asking the audience for their stories and then transforming it on stage?
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much what Luis Valdez did in the middle of the 60s, which is the birth of the Chicano movement, which we'll cover in the history sequence here. But he basically went to help Cesar Chavez with the grape strike, and he asked the workers, not actors, he asked the workers to kind of show him what was going on today when the boss came out and talked to you. So the workers would create these scenes.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, start with your audience and build the show from them. So that was don't want to say that's the origins of community-based theater, but that's a perfect example of it. We've certainly always been drawing our stories from the audience. But in recent years, we actually have developed theater companies that specialize in doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Even before we created our Dominguez Bridge Theater Company, which was a community-based theater here, we had Teatro Dominguez doing such things as the Floating Voices Project, one of the unique projects that I had Naomi involved in. In fact, you'll see her in this clip here that we're going to show. Do you remember how far back this goes?
I think the last time I taught this class, we showed that clip, and I was astonished at how young I looked.
Oh, really? Okay. So this is a perfect example of what we mean by community-based theater, because when the tsunami hit in, was that 2006? Trying to remember the exact year.
It was before that.
Before that even, right?
It was like 2004, 2005.
Yeah. Our students wanted to do something about it. So they researched online some of the stories that people were telling about their experience in the tsunami. And so we drew this from actual accounts. And as you'll see, when you hear the actors talking, now these are our actors talking, but they're all lines that were written by people involved in the crisis. So it is a unique experience of community-based theater. So this is just a short little sequence of Floating Voices by Teatro Dominguez.
Indonesia.
Thailand.
India.
Sri Lanka.
Malaysia.
Myanmar. Bangladesh. Maldives.
Madagascar. Mauritius. Somalia.
Kenya. South Africa. Australia.
Banda Aceh. Phuket. Andaman.
Penang. KwaZulu-Natal. Dar es Salaam.
127,774 missing.
4,499 missing.
6,000 missing.
6 missing.
26 missing.
166,320 dead.
5,313 dead.
16,000 dead.
50,000 dead.
68 dead.
298 dead.
My name is Sanjay. The first thing I saw in Malatibu was a battered board hanging outside a building that read Sentinel Children's Home. 150 war orphans abandoned during the fighting lived there. When the ceasefire was signed 3 years ago, it looked like these children would have a future. Now, only 5 of them are alive. A wrought iron bed wrapped around a mango tree was for me the most telling thing about the force of the wave. It looked like a straw wrapped around a Coke bottle. I tried to bend it back. I couldn't even move it. In the storeroom, where food and supplies were stored for the children, the floor was littered with sweets. A bag containing about 1,000 sweets had exploded upon impact with the wall and was now tossed about the room. They'd been brought there by the home matrons to give to the good kids. I could remember getting that extra piece of toffee if I was good. And now, no one will ever eat those toffees again.
So you can see, this is actual words that were written by participants, but then in the production, we use them in what we called floating voices. In fact, we did it at the Armstrong Theater in Torrance to help raise money for, there was a huge effort to get money and supply, medical supplies over there. So it was interesting to write that play so quickly and stage it there.
Yeah, so it's an example also, as we were talking about while we were watching it, of something called verbatim theater, since I know you guys are kind of learning about all different kinds of theater, and community-based theater being one of them. And another example of that would be like the Laramie Project that was written by Moises Kaufman and the Teutonic Theater Group, where they went and interviewed a group of people and then took, you know, pretty much exactly what those people said and then turned them into a theatrical piece. And this is exactly what the playwrights did in this situation, where they went online and they took actual interviews. So those are actual things that people said. They're not fictionalized, they're not enhanced, and they might have been edited, but they are the real words that people were saying. So it's kind of, it's an example of both. It's community-based in that we were, we had social and political action that we were doing with it, but at the same time, it's also an example of a type of theater called verbatim theater, which I think is very interesting, yeah.
I mentioned before we were talking about how there's a kind of mirror effect, in Danielle's comment. To me, what a community-based theater is the perfect way to see theater as a mirror. I mean, after all, we are staging what the lives of our audience members are about. So it really does kind of make that symbol come into sharp focus. Naomi, I want to get your comment on some of the comments that are coming in. I've got Brandon
got a
here.
Lot.
Yeah, Brandon is saying, "How come I seem to always allow the willing suspension of disbelief to grab a hold of me in theater, but not as much in film or television shows?" That's interesting, Brandon. You find that it's easier for you to go along with and buy into a show that's live rather than a film or television show.
I think that might have to do with the word you were talking about, aesthetic distance. That, you know, we always need to have aesthetic distance. That's part of what that audience-performer relationship is all about. In fact, in some ways, you can't really have a real piece of theater without it. It turns into something else, like, you know, drama therapy or some kind of other form. But it's not just, I think, you know, it's not just the physical space, it's also an intellectual space that's created between you and the audience. But I think when we're thinking about film and television, your space is even larger, right? Mm-hmm. Because this is a dead form. This has already been recorded. No matter what your reaction in it is, it has no effect on the performer. And so that's a very huge difference between television and film and the theater. Whereas in the theater, not only are you in this community experience where you're sitting with other audience members, and yes, you do that in the movie theater, but you're watching live performers. And even though you may not realize it, you think you realize it on an intuitive level that your responses and your attention affects that performance. Mm-hmm. And vice versa. The way the performers behave affect you as well.
Even so if you're sitting there and not saying anything,
right,
and not doing anything, you still know that you could affect that performer. There's a kind of connection there that, I don't know, maybe that's it, Brandon, that you feel that kind of live connection that draws your feelings out a little bit more. I think it's interesting what you say about the aesthetic distance there. There is a distance, but it's not a very long one in theater.
No.
It's very short. It grabs you. Let's see, we have Ember Storrs making a comment here too. As a crazy, weird, and random person, I enjoy spontaneous movies and plays with a twist. Your background or personal experiences definitely have an impact on what you are interested in watching, because what you see is probably going to affect you. Because what you are used to feels natural. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it very much is a reflection of who you are, what you're seeing up there. That's great, Ember. So yes, you're a crazy, weird, and random person. We'll have to learn more about you in the future. Oh, and here's G. Meacham. Professor DeLuca, when my family and myself went to see Lee Daniels' Butler this past fall, starring Forrest Whitaker and Oprah Winfrey, most of my family cried. The reason they were crying is because the other ones felt the pain and the experience, what happened, and was reliving again. I, being young, did not understand and had many questions for them during the film. I'm sure that was a very interesting mm-hmm. process to go through, to ask your family members why they were affected like that. Mm-hmm. Forrest Whitaker is so wonderful. I find him so unique. He's actually working on campus with us right now.
Oh, is he again? Yeah. He's been on campus a few times.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. So very exciting. Well, listen, I want to bring them also to the Dominguez Bridge Project, because we created a theater company called the Dominguez Bridge Theater Company, and it was dedicated to doing community-based theater. And our first project kind of set the tone, very much so, the Carson Bridge Project. Our university is located in Carson, California. So we interviewed over 100 people from Carson, from the mayor on down to people who were working in senior citizen centers. We interviewed firemen. It was a wonderful process, rather exhaustive. I mean, we took 3 months, 4 months to do this, and we sent students out to get interviews, tape them, play them back. So Naomi, as well as one of our students, Brenda Arietta, basically wrote this play together. It's always often hard to write a play with two sometimes, but they came up with the Dominguez Bridge Project. I think we have a clip of the Carson Bridge
right.
Project too. I think we're just in the interest of time, we're going to have to move on to the Dominguez Bridge Project. So if you guys can cue that up. But the Carson Bridge Project was also very unique, because from those interviews, we also learned about the history of Carson and featured Manuel Dominguez, who actually controlled this whole 75,000 acres for many, many years when it was a Spanish land grant. So we factored in a little bit of the history of Carson as well. But came the time with the Dominguez Bridge Theater Company to write a show that featured the history of our campus. So Naomi and Brenda basically interviewed faculty members, staffers, people who had been here in the late 60s. I mean, they went back to some interesting characters and brought back the whole history. And then the play that you structured actually was done in decades. So we looked at the 70s at Dominguez Hills. We looked at the 80s. And I think the clip that we have is from the Dominguez Bridge Project is going to look at the section on the 60s.
I think so it's the protest scene, yeah?
The protest scene?
Yeah,
okay, great.
The love-in.
We had a love-in on campus here at Dominguez Hills back in the 60s. And this shows a protest that was actually held here, and it factors in some of the issues that were talked about at the protest here on campus. So this is from the Dominguez Bridge Project, written by Brenda Arrieta and Naomi Buckley.
Committed to us and the quality of education will diminish. Of all the state campuses, this one is most at risk. We need the money to fulfill our commitments to you. Without it, all that we have all worked so hard for will be in jeopardy.
Hear our voices! Hear our voices!
California colleges are a people's college.
Right.
If tuition were imposed, it would deter many from getting an education. An education that is necessary for themselves and their communities. There will always be students who just cannot afford $300 or $400. That's rent and food for a month. We barely make enough to live as is. Someone once said to me,
I don't see why you can't just work your way through college instead of relying on handouts.
Well, I say to them, do you have a father, mother, a brothers and sisters that you help to support?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's where all my money goes.
Yeah.
Hey, I didn't realize this school had been so politically active back in the day.
Oh, yeah, Kevin. Corey and I found a ton of material in the archives.
Yeah, there have always been demonstrations on campus. Hear our voices! Hear our voices. We black people are a part of this campus too.
That's right.
We deserve representation. Black students all across America are saying enough.
Yeah.
Did you mean it when you said all men are created equal?
Speak, sister.
Well, we have been treated everything but equal.
That's right.
I remember being a little girl and recognizing I was treated different from the white kids I went to school with. Well, enough. We deserve to be treated equal to every citizen living in this country. Colleges are just now starting to recognize the importance of helping us second-class citizens advance. Our student government does not reflect the black population.
No.
And our faculty does not represent us.
Even in 2007, our faculty still does not represent us.
We demand representation in the student government and in the faculty.
Yeah.
We demand a major dedicated to the study of who we are and what we're about.
Yeah.
We deserve to have our voices heard.
Yes.
We demand a black student union and we want it now.
Yeah. Our voices.
We must have called for a Mexican-American studies major. We may not constitute a majority of this campus,
but we
have a unique voice and culture that should be heard and honored just as much as any other culture.
So you see that we actually got a point there where there was a protest on campus to start a black student union. So this was very 60s and 70s. And Naomi and Brenda did a lot of research here at the Archive Center on campus, went through newspaper accounts, and boy, community-based theater sounds like a lot of fun, but there was a lot of work involved. What was the process like for you and Brenda to put this together?
I think it's what's interesting about community-based theater as opposed to, again, like verbatim theater, is that you have this large, this big time of information gathering that happens, right? And I mean, like with this, I mean, we spent 6 months, I think, information gathering and researching. So you have this large period of time when you're information gathering and you get a lot of information. And it's interesting. And there's like so many interesting stories mm-hmm. that you hear from people. I mean, we heard so many stories. We could have filled three plays, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, there was so many interesting things that have happened on campus and that the people who've met and gotten married and just everyday stories, beautiful stories. But the real task, I think the real challenge of it is finding the balance between something that's artistic and has a real story and has an arc and has conflict and is something that an audience is interested in hearing and has cohesiveness to it. And finding that through this menagerie of information is really challenging. And it was more challenging because there were two playwrights. So oftentimes we'd have different ideas. We're both very strong women. And so sometimes we'd butt heads over it and we'd try and figure it out. Fortunately, we had Bill there to moderate. But I think that was probably the most challenging thing. It was how do you sift through all of this and then how do you find the balance between the craft of playwriting and the sort of art of that and being just a factual storyteller. You want to blend those two. You want to create something that's theatrical and interesting and has plot and conflict and movement and all these things. So that was a big challenge, was figuring out how to do that and organizing all that information. You want to tell everybody's story once you hear them, you know. So how do you put that together, you know?
Well, I really want you to talk in the same way about your process of doing the Brenda Project. Now, this was the final chapter of our Dominguez Bridge Theater Company. The Brenda Project was motivated, first of all, by the loss of our very good friend, Brenda Killian, who died at the age of 31, leaving two small children. I mean, it was a real heartbreak for us to lose Brenda, and she was very instrumental in creating the company. So there was an emotional connection there in losing Brenda to breast cancer at such an early age. So one of the things that Brenda wanted to do was to write a play about breast cancer. She wanted to interview survivors. So we decided to take that on. And basically, Naomi and Susan Thrasher, another alum and friend of Brenda, decided to take this on. And I mean, tell them a little bit about the process of the interviews that we did, because it was kind of unique to mm-hmm. try to structure and arrange an interview with someone who was dealing with going through such a horrendous process of radiation therapies or chemo. But we all found them very willing to tell their story.
Mm-hmm. And it was really interesting. I think I thought, as I think Susan did, that we were going to go in and it was going to be like every time we walked out of these interviews, we were going to be depressed. We were going to be so sad. And mm-hmm. I think what was surprising about it was that every time we were honored with the presence of these amazing women, and because it was breast cancer, we primarily were speaking with women. You walked away feeling inspired and hopeful and like, you know, just invigorated by their stories. They had such amazing stories. They were so strong. They had such insights. They, you know, they were just inspiring. And Brenda was inspiring, you know. So it was quite fitting that we interview these women and we hear their stories, and we try to figure out how to blend those stories together. What were the common themes that we were seeing over and over again, and how could we connect them back to Brenda's story, which in many ways was really unique because, I don't think Bill said this, but she, not only was she incredibly young, but she was diagnosed while she was pregnant with her second mm-hmm. child. So she had to make this horrific choice as to, you know, do I get chemo while I'm pregnant with my child? And her story was heartbreaking. It was very close to all of us, especially Susan, who is a best friend to Brenda. And so it was sometimes a difficult process to sit down and write these scenes. You felt a huge amount of responsibility to do not only Brenda justice, but these women and their stories, and to give them their due and to make their stories feel compelling. And it was a heart-wrenching yeah. process, but I think it was well worth it, and it I think touched many of the women that we saw and spoke with and that came and saw the show were very touched and moved by the experience.
You were telling the story of miracles. I mean, for instance, that whole thing of Brenda taking chemo while she was pregnant. And as it turns out, I mean, there were a number of news articles that were done on her because Abigail was born totally healthy. So it was like people were shocked that that could happen. So there was that technical miracle. But like you explained, so many of these women and their stories were just, something happens to a family when a crisis occurs. And it was so interesting to see how many women were there with members of their family talking about how their relationships have changed as a result of going through this process of breast cancer. So it was, we were like interviewing whole families. I mean, we were getting entire stories, not just one of personal grief. And I felt the same way. I was going in expecting it to be very, very disheartening, but it became an amazing kind of look at the kind of integrity of the human spirit
to be able to
fight back.
I think one of them, and I know that we're coming towards the end of this, but I think one of the things we heard over and over again, which was so surprising, was that a lot of women, more than one woman, said that they felt like cancer was a gift, that they were like grateful in some ways that they had, you know, gotten cancer, you know, and you're like, how can you say that? You know, like, how is that, you know, like, and just their, what they were talking about was that, you know, that they kind of walked to the edge of the precipice and looked over and realized how lucky they were, how important their lives were, how important their families were, what, you know, life means. And I think that's kind of also what we tried to build into the story that we wrote, which was kind of this metaphysical, this spiritual element that was so present with so many of these people, that there is more than just this life. And whatever you believe, heaven or, you know, Valhalla or whatever, that there's more than right here and right now.
In fact, if we could just take a quick look and show them on my computer screen, I have an image from the show that shows you what a wonderful mystical piece that she and Susan wrote. This is an image, I guess I can't get it larger, can I? But there's this kind of tree of life, and all the women are in white, and it's kind of unique. This is Mama, I don't know that you can see her here, but she's knitting this shawl that actually the women kind of are comforted by. So it was a very realistic set of interviews, but the show that was created was a wonderful abstraction and quite a testament to not just Brenda, but many of the women that you interviewed. Well, I knew we would run out of time. Sorry about that, Naomi.
It's okay. But, it was nice being here.
It's been great talking to you about the audience, and thank you so much for coming. Come and see some more of her work.
Yes, and Top Dog Underdog.
Yes.
Coming up.
Yes, that's coming up as well. So we'll see you next week.
Bye.